Welcome to the video presentation of the ET335 waveforms and oscilloscopes. Here we see our analog waveforms. So we have analog and digital waveforms, basically. Here we have our sine wave using basically communication. And we see a damped sine wave, which would be oscillators and other kinds of devices. So we have a sawtooth and a triangular wave. These are waveforms that will be produced by a generator, a function generator. And on the bottom, we have a square wave, which uses a 50% duty cycle, so it looks squarish. And a rectangular wave will be using different duty cycles, which I'll cover in a little bit. So, but you notice here that our square and rectangle waves go positive and minus, just like our other analog waves. Here we're showing other type of analog waveforms, which could also be considered digital. We have a step, which would be the result of a pulse input or square pulsed input, and how fast that circuitry would react to it. Then we have a pulse. You're going to see these in the microprocessor class, where we will trigger devices with a single positive pulse. This we see a pulse train, which was multiple pulses in a row, and this could be random or periodic. And then we have a complex, which would be the new digital type signals for communication. Here I'm showing digital waveforms, and what we have here is an ideal pulse. The transistor instantaneous and portions between the transitions are flat. This would be output of our function generator. Once we go through the digital circuitry, they're not going to be this square and nice. Why digital is different than the square wave is we're going to start at zero, go to some voltage. Square or rectangular waveform goes from high to low, so it's going to go plus and minus. The digitals are going to go from zero to some voltage. The TTLs are going to be 0 to 5 volts, and the CMOS could be pretty much anything nowadays from zero to some voltage. Our definitions here, we have a rising edge or positive going transition from low to high, and the falling edge or negative going transition, which will go from high to low. So when we say low, it's 0 volts. When we say high, it would be the maximum volts, TTL would be 5 volts. Here's a periodic waveform. Periodic means continuously pulsing. And what we have here is our pulse width, which is the time high, okay? Here is period, this is tau, not T. And it is the total time of the wave of the pulse. So we have any time that it repeats, that would be the period. So we have time high and time low. So any time that this repeats, that would be another period. Here we have pulse repetition frequency. This has to do with frequency equals 1 over tau, or the period. Okay, so we have 1 over time high plus time low, which would be the total time, or the period. And if we inverse that, we would have the number of pulses per second. So this would be frequency, and the other one was going to be the times of the pulse. So here we see 3 cycles per second. Our period would be 1 wave. And 1 second, we would count the number of waves, and that would give us the frequency. Here we have the concept of duty cycle. Duty cycle would be the time high, or pulse width, over the total time, which is the period. And a good example of this would be a welding machine. They come with duty cycles that you could weld. In this case, you could weld for 25, let's say 25 minutes, and the machine needs to rest for 75 minutes. And that's in order to cool the electronics. So this is the same thing in digital. We have no way to do analog voltages other than use a digital to analog converter. But what we can do is we could use pulse width and run it through a let's say a DC motor, and the motor and some other filters would go through and combine that. So what we have at 25%, if you integrate it over a period of time, it's going to be 25% of the voltage. So if we have 5 volts at 100%, 25% of that will be like 1.25 volts. So it works well for driving different things. So a duty cycle is basically a way to get an analog voltage out of digital systems. I'm going to talk about oscilloscope terminology. Graticles are these lines on the oscilloscope, vertical and horizontal lines, and that allows us to measure the waveforms. Amplitude is this voltage, okay, and we could adjust how we look at this voltage. In this case, it's 5 volts per graticle or box. So we count 1, 2, 3, 4 times 5. This would be a 20 volt peak-to-peak sine wave. Okay, time base is the way we set this time. Also is count graticle. So here we have, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4 and a half maybe. And so we have, let's just say, between 800 and 1,000 microseconds. And we have tools that we can measure that much more accurately. The zero arrow is right here. It shows 0 volts. So this sine wave is going plus and it's going negative. This is movable. On the old analog scopes, this was fixed. But we could move this zero arrow anywhere else because everything's computerized. Okay, the trigger arrow isn't shown here, but we need to lock this signal in, and we'll do that by triggering, and you'll see it on this side. So what we want to do is see the yellow arrow, the trigger arrow on this side, pointing to the yellow output. So if you're using blue channel, you want to use the blue arrow on the blue output signal. And trigger start arrow is right here. So there's a cross between somewhere in here, and that's where the signal gets locked in and starts. Ignore this down here. This has to do with where the trigger crosses. So this is just give us information on how this is triggered. It helps us find the trigger arrow when it gets lost, and you can tell if it's up very high or very low. But other than that, it's not very useful. Here we have the measurement function, and we could set it and select whatever we want from a fairly significant list of different devices. So we could go ahead and set frequency, and it'll tell us how many pulses we have per second. We could check the period. We can measure peak to peak, and we could do RMS, which is a arithmetic measurement of the area under the curve, and for measuring mainly AC type waves. Our scopes also have a cursor function, and we could set this up with time, and we could do multiple channels. And what we do is we set this, and the knobs are going to turn green, or the light LED is below the knobs, and we could adjust these cursors. And now I could measure the period. Here we're using our cursor functions for voltage. So here I'm measuring peak to peak, But we could move this cursor along here and we could get positive peak or negative peak or whatever measurement we want. This is the position of the one cursor, this is the position of the other one. Here's delta, which is the difference between the two, is what we want to look at. Here we're looking at a square wave because it's 50% duty cycle. And you notice it goes positive and negative. So this will be a square wave. If we change the duty cycle a little bit, it becomes a rectangular wave. It's not a TTL signal or digital signal that we'll be using. Here's a setup that we could use in order to do TTL signals. Here's our tektronic scope. We click on it. We're going to get one that looks just like the one that we have in lab. And here's our function generator. But in order to do TTL, we have to set amplitude to 2.5 and offset at 2.5 volts DC. That's in order for us to get a TTL wave. Here we see TTL, it's 0 to 5 volts. Okay, there are easier ways to do this. And if we wanted different signals, we would use a different function generator. I found this to be the best way in order to create a TTL signal. Use our standard scope, make sure it's grounded. And this is a clock voltage from signal sources. So when we use a clock voltage, it makes it very easy for me to create CMOS and TTL type signals. Here we're showing to create CMOS signals. CMOS are the old style and very new style logic devices, and their voltages are from 0 to whatever the maximum of this function generator is. The old time stuff was plus 3 to 18 volts. Those are obsolete. But we have things now working at 3.5, 1.8, 1.2. So a lot of these devices are using different signals, and this could create it. So here we can manipulate the voltage. Here I have 10 volts peak to peak from 0 to 10. And also I could change the duty cycle very easily, and you could see that it appears that 75% is high and 25% is low. And we could do the calculation 750 microseconds over 1,000 microseconds, and it comes out to 75%. Take this number and multiply it by 100% and you've got it. Here I'm showing some basic setup. We need to go to channel 1 menu or whichever channel we're using, push this, and we need to use DC coupling cores and leave invert off. Okay, there's a fine setting, but you have to turn the knob to get the voltage we need. AC coupling puts a capacitor in line and it'll block out all the AC. It's probably okay for what we're doing most of the time, but it's best to leave it at DC. If you turn invert on, it'll completely invert the signal, so plus will be minus and vice versa. Here we have trigger settings, so we need to use edge, the channel we are, rising or falling depending, and mode auto will be fine, coupling DC, and we need to make sure that our arrow is touching the waveform.